not attempt to adjust the picture. We are controlling transmission.
From intergalactic excursions and time travelers to aliens and renegade robots, join host William Shatner and some very special guests for a spectacular behind-the-scenes look at some of the strangest and most out-of-this-world television shows ever made. TV Guide looks at science fiction.
They've amazed us, challenged us, frightened us, and even brought us where no man or woman has gone before. For nearly half a century, science fiction television shows have offered audiences spectacular ideas, unlimited possibilities, and worlds where dreams can come true. During the next 60 minutes, we will examine some of the best and most extraordinary episodes from TV's greatest science fiction series. And we'll do it without the help of elaborate gimmicks and special effects. Well, maybe just one or two.
Travel back through time to the earliest days of TV science fiction when TV Guide looks at science fiction returns.
It's hard to believe, but television itself was once thought of as science fiction. The idea that pictures, along with sounds, could be transmitted through the air was thought to be strange, fantastic, and unbelievable. It hardly seems surprising that when TV did become a reality, science fiction shows weren't far behind. The date, June 27th, 1949. The time, 7 p.m. Children of the prosperous post-war baby boom were about to meet TV's first science fiction hero. Set in the 22nd century, Captain Video was a sci-fi superhero who used a variety of gadgets and gizmos to battle cosmic villains.
How is Captain Video going to feel when he learns that I, Dr. Foley, his bitterest enemy, has also reached the outer limit?
Incredibly. The show's special effects budget was only $25 a week. But Captain Video's immense popularity ushered in a golden age of science fiction series aimed primarily at children.
Hi, you future space cadet. Maybe I can tell you more about what's going on here at Space Academy.
Another show that jumped on Captain Video's intergalactic coattails was Tom Corbett, Space Cadet, starring Frank Thomas as a curly-haired student at a futuristic space academy.
Nice takeoff, Dr. Dow.
Thank you, Tom.
At the end of the second week, we knew we had it made because all of the disc jockeys and everybody picked up our lingo. Spaceman's luck, go blow your jets by the rings of Saturn.
Only suckers would fall for that routine about soldiers of peace and freedom.
By the freighters of Luna, I think
easy there. Don't blast your jets.
Let them go. Think I'm afraid to fight?
No. But another crack out of you and I'll start operating. Now get going. Blast off.
All right, Junior, take it easy. Your halo's getting crooked.
It just happened. I didn't believe it. It was just wild. We liked it, you understand. But we didn't really expect it. We couldn't. It was sort of a 5-year phenomenon. Perhaps the most impressive early science fiction show was Space Patrol.
All right, Cadet. Now operate the controls that take us back into the past.
Nothing doing. Go ahead, shoot me. But I'm not playing rocket jockey for you space tramps.
You don't seem to understand your position, young man. Why do you crank up this ship and head into the past? Or something permanent happens to the lady back on our ship?
Considered by many to be the Star Trek of its day, the series followed the adventures of the spaceship Terra on its mission to protect the United Planets of the Universe.
I'm sorry, Commander. We've had no report from either Cadet Happy or Carol Carlisle.
Well, contact me the second you have any word.
You won't get away with it. Buzz Corey will find you no matter where you hide.
Buzz Corey. I can see him now. He'll spend a week looking for the daughter of the Secretary General and the rest of his life searching all space and time for his cadet.
The atomic age also suggested that science had a darker side. Appealing to a more sophisticated adult audience, the science fiction anthology series often dealt with complex themes and stressed technology's more sinister ramifications. Science fiction anthologies was Rod Serling's The Twilight Zone.
This is a farmhouse. A house without electricity or gas. A house untouched by progress. This is the woman who lives in the house. A woman who's been alone for many years. A strong, simple woman whose only problem up until this moment has been that of acquiring enough food to eat. A woman about to face terror, which is, even now, coming at her from Twilight Zone.
For 5 years and 151 episodes, The Twilight Zone dealt with everything from the scientifically possible to the supernaturally implausible. But always with a strange and ironic twist at the end.
Mr. Robert Wilson has ended now. Happily, his conviction will not remain isolated too much longer. For happily, tangible manifestation is very often left as evidence of trespass, even from so intangible a quarter as the
my fellow citizens. And then return it safely to Earth and do all this and do it right and do it first before this dictator's out. Then we must be bold.
By the early 60s, more than 44 million American households had at least one television set, and the world held its breath while the incredible happened before its eyes. The paranoia of the 1950s was giving way to a new sense of optimism, and both children and adults could project themselves into a future where anything could happen.
How far out can you get?
Set in the then-distant year of 1997, Lost in Space thrilled audiences with its imaginative blend of science fiction, adventure, and fantasy.
Ladies and gentlemen, today the first of what may be as many as 10 million families per year is setting out on its epic voyage into man's newest frontier for colonization, deep space.
Created by Irwin Allen, later to be known as the Master of Disaster, for films like The Towering Inferno and The Poseidon Adventure, Lost in Space followed the adventures of the Robinson Party as they braved strange aliens, hostile terrain, and an evil villain named Dr. Zachary Smith.
Only one person is currently of use to us, Major Don West. Useful because he's the only one who can pilot this spaceship. Since the others serve no purpose, they must be liquidated. When we have learned what we need to know from Major West, he will be liquidated as well. With me so far?
Affirmative. Destroy everyone.
Villainy is easy. I've played many villains in my time. My most successful villains have been comedic villains. And I knew that. This began to sneak it in.
Indubitably. It must surely be time for lunch. I think you'd best go back to camp.
I shall give up presently.
You're not going to fool around with those gloves, are you?
Certainly not. I merely wish to be alone, to entertain my muse. Leave me.
Come on, Penny. He's in one of his moods.
Irwin not only allowed me to do that, but one day said, do more. And I did.
Eli! How dare you! That ball was practically in the dirt.
One more display of temper and I shall be forced to eject you from the game.
You will eject me? Why, you monstrous, mechanized, misguided moron!
Out! You are out of the game!
An instant hit with viewers, if not always with critics. Lost in Space and the crew of the Jupiter 2 traveled the galaxy for 3 seasons and 83 increasingly bizarre episodes. Lost in Space's colorful and imaginative approach was made it one of the most popular and best-loved science fiction shows of all time.
Excuse me, Bill, but you failed to mention that I was the star.
Well, Robot, you weren't exactly the only star of Lost in Space.
Tell that to my agent.
Next up, the attack of the mechanical men as TV Guide looks at science fiction.